One of the things I just want to mention, we don't really understand the power of God's Word. And you know, I don't think we should be superstitious about the Bible, like there's something magical about the pages, because it's about the message that's recorded here. But I do have to give you a testimony about a fellow. Many years ago, we were in a Bible conference. First time that I met Mark and Debbie Prater. I think it was in, I'm thinking that it's in Waco, but there was a fellow there whose daughter was institutionalized in the psych ward in the Houston Psychiatric Hospital, and she was just tormented by nightmares. She had no peace, and I don't know exactly what the emotional issues and everything were. And he told his daughter, take that Bible that I brought you and put it under your pillow at night. And he said she had done it earlier that week, and when she had the opportunity, we could only allow her to use the phone every so often. She called him and said, Dad, I'm sleeping well every night since I put the Bible under my pillow. So, I don't know what that means to you, but I do know that there's power in this word and in this book beyond our comprehension. And I've shared a number of testimonies along the way. I'll just mention again, you think about, 2 hours a night, 5 hours on Saturday, but let me tell you, it is transformative to spend that much time away from the things of the world and away from the life's problems and all that call to you, and to focus on God's Word. And many times when we're gathered like that, people who have serious physical problems get healed. Just be inundated with the Word of God and being present with other people that are studying God's Word. I can't explain it. I can't prove it to you from the Scripture, except that I know that the Bible says that He sent His Word and healed us. And including the fellow that was in our group in Colorado who was scheduled to have rotator cuff surgery. Couldn't raise his arm. And during the Bible conference, God just touched him. And we were singing some songs and we were going to go pray for him. And he's got his arms up in the air worshiping the Lord. And last time I saw him, 3 or 4 years ago, he said, no, he never had to have surgery on that shoulder. The Lord just completely healed him. We didn't get the anointing with oil or lay hands on him or anything like that. So I'm just telling you there's an opportunity. You know, it's sort of like, well, if we knew that Jesus was coming down the hill into Queen Valley here in a few weeks, would we shut everything down and take time to go see him? You know, I think about all the people that lived around Jericho that didn't come the day that Jesus was passing through Jericho. There were good crowds that were there, but Zacchaeus heard about it, and he wasn't going to let anything stand in the way, and being short with massive crowds, and of course you remember he climbed up in the tree, and look what happened for him. And I think a lot of times we have missed out on the opportunity to get some blessing and some help in our life from the Lord, because we just don't put ourselves in the right place geographically. So that's just for you to think about. Tonight, I want us to look at, and I've listed for you on the notes that you have there, just single verses that specifically make reference to healing or being healed. We've looked at a lot of scripture all through the Gospels and the letters. But I want to just back up and show you, this thing of God healing people physically has been a part of what God does for His people since the very beginning. And so we're going to start out here in Psalm 38. Verse 3 is the key verse. We're going to back up and read a little bit before that. He says, O Lord, rebuke me not in thy wrath. And this, by the way, is the Psalm of David. And David really is revealing some things about his relationship with the Lord. And he says as he goes on there, and chasten me not in thy burning anger. For thine arrows have sunk deep into me, and thine hand has pressed down on me. So what is he talking about? Arrows and being pressed down from the Lord. Well, it becomes evident as we read verse 3. There is no soundness in my flesh because of thine indignation. There is no health in my bones because of my David knew that whatever he was suffering with, he was suffering with that because of his own personal sin. And I'll remind you, that's only one of at least 9 reasons that we know of why people are physically sick. But David was so honest and was so open about himself, the way he would bear his heart. And by the way, his enemies could use a lot of the things that he said and did. They could use them against him. You know, that's how many of us have learned how to wear the fake mask, because we've been honest and then people have used it against us, you know. And there are times that we become vulnerable like that. You know, David wasn't concerned about what people were saying and thinking about him. David was concerned about honoring the Lord. And so he was honest, and he said, "There was no health in my bones because of my sin. For my iniquities are gone over my head. As a heavy burden, they weigh too much for me. My wounds grow foul and fester because of my folly. I'm bent over and greatly bowed down. I go mourning all day long. For my loins are filled with burning, and there's no soundness in my flesh. I am benumbered and badly crushed. I groan because of the agitation of my heart. Lord, all my desire is before thee, and my sighing is not hidden from thee. My heart throbs, my strength fails me. The light of my eyes, even that, has gone from me. My loved ones and my friends stand aloof from my plague, and my kinsmen stand far off. Those who seek my life lay snares for me, and those who seek to injure me have threatened destruction, and they have devised treachery all day long." And so he goes on, and it's really a sad state of affairs that he describes there, but he recognized what the problem was. And all of this learning to be honest and to look at what was going on is part of the process of him coming to God to be free and to get healed and to get well. Because we know he did not stay in that sickness. But it's pretty powerful, the verse 3. "There's no soundness in my flesh because of thine indignation. There's no health in my bones because of my sin." Go with me now to the 41st Psalm, or chapter 41. How blessed, starting at verse 1, "is he who considers the helpless. The Lord will deliver him in the day of trouble. The Lord will protect him and keep him alive. They will be called blessed upon the earth, and do not give him over to the desire of his enemies. The Lord will sustain him upon his sickbed. In his illness, thou dost restore him to health." So he was sick. He's crying out to the Lord, and he has confidence that the Lord is going to sustain him while he's sick, and he's going to get him through this, and he's going to be restored to health. And he says in verse 4, "As for me, I said, O Lord, be gracious to me. Heal my soul, for I have sinned against thee." And then he goes on about his enemies speaking against him, and all of these things that are going on all around him. But he, again, lays his soul bare and says blatantly, "Be gracious to me, heal my soul, for I've sinned against thee." And in this case, he was talking not about his physical body so much as he was in chapter 38 Psalm. He's talking more about the problem in his soul than in his heart. And we need to recognize that, you know, there are a lot of times that our body is not going to get well until our heart and our soul gets well. There is a direct correlation. And even those in the medical profession will tell you that people who have an optimistic and upbeat attitude are far more quickly recovering from catastrophic surgery, from catastrophic diseases and things that they've been afflicted with. It makes a difference. I'm understanding that a lot of the medical schools now are teaching classes about the connection between spiritual life and health. And of course, you can imagine there are a few places up in arms about it. Let's see, what are those initials? L-U? Yeah, okay. Funded by your taxpayers' dollars to constantly fight against that which is right, and that which is of God, and that which is profitable for our nation. And so the medical profession are beginning to see and to recognize that this spiritual side of man is really critical in healing and overcoming sickness and disease. Dr. Rick Gramer is going to be playing, going to bring his electric keyboard and provide us some music next week. And at some point, I don't know then or not, but he will tell us about the person. He's an anesthesiologist who's retired now, some of you know, and has just moved to Queen Valley permanently. And he was 20 minutes into filling out the paperwork to describe exactly what he did as he administered an anesthetic to a patient who immediately, when the anesthetic went in, the patient flatlined and was dead for 20 minutes. And he was crying out to the Lord, and he's thinking, oh gosh, you know, what have I done? And he's re-examining everything he's done. He's documenting it all. And he's crying out to the Lord from his heart in the midst of that, and boom, all of a sudden, 20 minutes later, the person comes back to life, and he was able to tear a hole in that paperwork and rejoice. So I don't know all the rest of the circumstances, but at some point we'll ask him to share a testimony about that. And of course, some of you are aware about what happened to Ken's wife. And were some of you present when you were praying? She is known as the miracle of Mountain View, is that?
Miracle of Mountain View.
Is it Mountain View?
Mountain Vista.
Mountain Vista. Miracle of Mountain Vista, yeah. Yeah.
It'd be interesting to find out what the people there say about it.
Yeah.
We were in there, you know.
They let a whole bunch of the people from the church go in and pray in ICU where she had flatlined. And Kathleen is here a lot of the nights, tall Kathleen. She was a cardiology nurse, and she's very familiar with this. And she went to Ken and said, I'm sorry, Ken, she's gone.
And two of us went in the room where she lay, and they were not doing anything for her. She was just laying on the gurney with a sheet stretched over her, and I mean, she's gone, God brought her back.
Down the bunch of folks right here, we're present there. And, you know, there's no medical explanation for what happened, but there is the mercy of God that is the explanation. Praise the Lord. I'm telling you, these kind of things are happening, but, you know, you won't read about it in the newspaper because it doesn't fit the story that those in charge of big media are crafting and trying to convince us it's all true. And it's pretty fantastic to hear that. We will ask Maddie to share that probably on a Sunday here sometime soon, because I just think it's so good for us to be grateful to God and show our gratitude to Him. And He tells us to tell of His good works, to tell of His great works. And I know for a lot of years, you know, I would hear people say, well, you know, I won't believe in the healing unless I see it with my own eyes. And my response to that is, you won't believe it even if you do see it with your own eyes. Because you see, seeing a miracle or being a witness or hearing a testimony about something like what I've just shared with you, that doesn't produce faith. But what does produce faith is right here. Getting the seed of this word implanted in the soil of our heart that enlightens our minds and allows us to begin to grow in this thing called faith, which is an essential ingredient in our relationship with God. I do want to remind you that is not the only ingredient that is necessary for healing to take place. But it is an essential ingredient. It's only one of them. And I think there have been some groups going around teaching about healing that have led a lot of people astray because they talk about it all being about the faith. But there's more to it than that. And faith is important, but it's not the only thing. And we're gonna see a verse about that a little bit later on here. Proverbs 3, third proverb. In verse 1, he says, my son, do not forget my teaching, let your heart keep my commandments. I do remember being taught in the preacher school that you can't teach theology or doctrine out of the Proverbs, because these were simply words of wisdom that that Solomon was speaking to his sons. And, you know, back then, I described it this way, I have the big funnel. Oh, okay, you're the smart guy. Makes sense to me. And then I'm reading along over here a little bit later in Hebrews, and it says, and don't forget the instruction addressed to you as sons. And he quotes right out of Proverbs and says, it's God talking to us. My son, do not regard lightly the discipline of the Lord, nor faint when you're reproved by him. For he whom the Lord loves, he disciplines and he scourges every son whom he receives. So, believe in the smart guys, theology experts, the lawyers, or believe in Jesus and the Word of God. Sorry guys, see you later. I'm going with Jesus. And so here we are. This is Solomon. Physically, that's the way this was presented. But spiritually, the Holy Spirit wrote it as God's message for us. He goes on in verse 2 and says, for length of days and years of life and peace, they will add to you. They what? The commandments of the Lord, the teaching of His Word. Don't let kindness and truth leave you. Bind them around your neck. Write them on the tablet of your heart. So you'll find favor and good repute in the sight of God. Amen. And then he says in verse 5, trust in the Lord with all your heart. And do not lean on your own understanding. And that's why I'm not trying to explain how a woman is tormented by nightmares, puts a Bible under her pillow, and she rests peacefully. I can't explain that. How is it that studying the Word of God, when you know it's a physical injury that tears the rotator cuff and makes the arm unusable, how, while reading the Bible, God just reaches down and can touch somebody and heal that? I don't know. I cannot explain it to you. But I rejoice in it, and I'm grateful to God for it. And I was an eyewitness because right when the meeting started, I said to him, Richard, tonight we're going to pray for you. Boy, I really appreciate it because he would just barely bend his elbow. He was in so much pain up here. And then I looked over there and he's worshiping the Lord. It kind of reminds me, you know, this thing about faith. It kind of reminds me of when you're thinking about injuries. And Wednesday night, our little church in Mesa, we were getting together. And it's one of those Wednesday nights that, you know, I looked around and there's about eight people there. And I go, boy, God, these people just really don't appreciate me as a pastor and my teaching and everything I'm doing. And, you know, what a waste of time. Only got about eight people here, you know. And one of the guys that came in was... Some of you remember Lynn Brown, who she's moved back to North Carolina, but she was with us in January. She brought a sweet little lady, brought in some dishes and desserts and everything here several times. Well, it was her husband, Cy. He came in, and he's a big, strong, tough guy. He actually shot down over Vietnam twice, was a POW twice, escaped twice, then he was the sheriff. And then he became a pitcher for the Cincinnati Reds. He played with, who's the guy who's banned from the Hall of Fame? What's that?
Pete Rose.
Pete Rose, yeah, he played with Pete Rose and those guys. He did all kinds of things. Anyways, an interesting fellow, still holds the record for the most no-hitters pitched in the minor leagues. He said the record books say that he pitched six, but he actually threw seven no-hitters before they moved him up to the big leagues. And in his first game pitching in Dodger Stadium, he hit a home run his first at bat, which is not that unusual for pitchers who are just coming up, because in the minor leagues, they actually practice batting. So it's not that extraordinary. But the second time up, he thought he hit a home run again, and it caromed off the top of the wall, and he had already rounded first, and he slid into second base and broke his throwing wrist at the end of his career. So this is Cy. So now he's doing construction work. He's in our church in Mesa. And he comes in, and he's holding his right arm like this. He says, oh man, I've really done it now. He said, I've been to the doctors. They say I've got carpal tunnel. I've injured it doing construction work. He says, Rick, it's so, he was shaking hands left handed. He said, it's so painful, just a wiggle finger. I can barely tolerate the pain. And he said, you know, I really need you guys to pray for me tonight. So I'm going, well, of course we'll pray. In the back of my mind, I'm going, I really don't know any place in the Bible that gives specific description of Jesus healing an injury. Now, it's possible that some of the people that, you know, were paralyzed and things, it could have been from an injury, but I don't know specifically. I don't have a verse that tells me that he did that. But you know, we'll ask, you know, this is what's running through my head. So we do our Bible study and I'm having a pity party, you know, nobody appreciates me. And afterward, we pulled a chair up and he sat down, and there were about five of us. A couple of people had to leave, there were about five of us there that began to pray. And I'm doing the praying. I'm not knowing if God heals injuries or not, but you know, we're going to ask. And so I felt really strongly about talking to the devil and telling him to get out and leave alone in the process of that. And that doesn't always happen, but sometimes it happened that particular night, and I'm thinking, this is an injury. What does that have to do with the devil? You know, because it's, it has to do with the nerves, I guess, passing through the elbow and maybe from the wrist. And I don't know exactly what it was, but you know, a guy who isn't a kid anymore thinks he can, you know, he's Mr. Atlas and all that, he kind of overdo some things. That, so here he is injured. So after we finished praying, I looked down and I said, well, Si, how do you feel? And he said, I really feel good. I'm thinking, well, that's great. He's going to, you know, just be of good cheer in the midst of this. And he said, you know, I'm going to have to be off work for a few weeks. I'm going to do the surgery, and I've got the rehab. And it's going to, you know, be probably 3 or 4 months before I can work again, you know. And he reaches his right hand toward me. And I'm kind of going. Now, he was only about 6 feet tall, but he was almost that wide, big barrel-chested guy. And I put my hand down there, and he grabs my hand with his right hand, and he almost crushed it. And I went, oh, my goodness, God healed you. The prayer of faith was so strong from him. And we went to jumping for joy. And you know what we decided? If there's only 6 or 8 people, it really doesn't matter when Jesus shows up. It doesn't matter. I've been in crowds of thousands where Jesus didn't show up. I just soon be with 6 or 8 people where Jesus shows up. By the way, he goes back to work the next day. And his boss said, what are you doing here? Get off of our lot, away from the shop here, you know. You can't come back to work till the doctor's cleared. He said, no, the church prayed for me last night, and the Lord healed me, so I'm fine. And he went right back to work, and he never had to have the surgery. And that's where we come to Proverbs 3:5. Just trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make your path straight. His testimony was this, and by the way, he had had a heart attack sometime after that, and the Lord gave him 15 years. The Lord gave my dad 15 years after the heart attack, and my best friend, one of my best friends in Colorado, Randy, 15 years to the day, and Si passed shortly, a little bit longer than 15 years after he had a heart attack, so I don't know if there's something about that, but he described what happened. He said, when you started talking to the devil, he said, the pain was so excruciating, starting at the shoulder. He said, I could barely sit there while you're praying. He said, I cried out and I said, Lord, I can't stand this pain anymore. His fingers were numb. He said, I can deal with the numbness, but I just can't deal with the pain. And he said, it shot out of his hand. And his middle two fingers had some numbness. Of course, we had no idea. I'm just praying and going, gosh, God, I don't want to be here. So we just trust in him. We don't try to figure it all out, okay? Because I'm here to tell you, I'm not an expert about this thing about sick people getting well. But I sure love getting in on it. I sure love being a part of it. And I sure love being a witness to it. And I rejoice as we lean on the Lord, because I can't chase off a runny nose or a little fever. I certainly can't heal carpal tunnel or rotator cuff, but I know somebody who can, and I'm not afraid to ask him because he wants us to ask him. He goes on in verse 7, he says, do not be wise in your own eyes, fear the Lord, turn away from evil. It will be healing to your body and refreshment to your bones. How about that? It'll be healing to your body and refreshment to your bones. Beautiful. This is written hundreds and hundreds of years before Jesus Christ came physically in the world. Go to the 4th Proverb. Verse 20. were instructed again, my son, give attention to my words, incline your ear to my sayings. Do not let them depart from your sight. Keep them in the midst of your heart, for they are life to those who find them, and health to all their whole body. Wow. How about that? The Word of God is health to you. You know, it's interesting. Sometimes, especially when you're dealing with people that have not had much experience to pray for sick or, you know, haven't experienced that for themselves. You know, they pray and then they're like, gosh, I don't know why it worked for them, it didn't work for me. But you know, it's amazing. A doctor gives us some of these little white pills. And he says, I want you to take these pills now for the next 10 days. And what do? We take one and we say, this doesn't work. I'm not any better. But somehow we have enough confidence that we take another one and another one. And we do that for 8 or 10 days. And sometimes you get better, sometimes we don't. But you know, part of what we need to learn to do in our desire to experience healing from God is take the Word of God when you're taking medicine. Remember a friend of mine down in San Antonio some years ago, he was lying on the couch and he caught some kind of bug and had a high fever. And his little elementary school daughter came in and she said, Daddy, now I have your medicine for you. And she read some scriptures about healing from Jesus and she said, take your medicine, Daddy. Wow. I'm telling you. It's not just you. It's amazing. So, I love it when God shows up and immediately heals somebody. But I rejoice that Shirley got some nights of sleep. That's fantastic. And I bet that you might have a thing or two to say about how nice it is too, Bruce. Praise the Lord. That's awesome. But I wish you'd been completely healed. But it's not up to me. But you know what we're going to ask God again tonight. Because, you know, she had a little medicine last week. Touch from the Lord, some word. Gave her some peace, got her some rest. So we're going to ask the Lord again tonight. Likewise. This word says, it's life to those who find it. Health to their whole body. Are you beginning to get the picture? As we go to the 16th Proverb. Are you beginning to get the picture that really, this is just all over the place here. Back in the old days, long before Jesus came. Why was it that the Pharisees were not teaching about Jesus, or about God being a healer, they wouldn't have known as Messiah? Why is it they weren't? They ignored all this. And I suspect that probably very much like today, some of them probably looked at everything and said, well, you know, God just, all the healing stopped back after Elisha. You know, God doesn't do the miracles of healing anymore. See, it's the same kind of explanation that we hear as people reduce what the Scripture says down to what our experience is. And the Lord wants us to go the other direction. Where were we? 16th Proverb? Okay. Verse 24 is the key verse. But let's read, let's start at 20, oh gosh, all of these are so good. But we can't go too far back. Let's start at 22. Understanding is a fountain of life to him who has it. But the discipline of fools is folly. The heart of the wise teaches his mouth. Isn't that interesting? And adds persuasiveness to his lips. Pleasant words are a honeycomb, sweet to the soul and healing to the bones. Praise the Lord. Pleasant words. You see, sometimes you get around people that pronounce all these bad things on you. You just need to get away from them. Amen. Sometimes sometimes it comes from people who mean well. Oh, that's the first sign. This is going to get worse. And you know what we do? We go, sometimes if we lie down, let him run over us like that. Now, what's real is real, okay? And God is not calling us into a fantasy world. I believe when Jesus heals people, they're healed. There, you know, there may be a progression. You know that the lepers turned and started obeying what Jesus said and headed to go show themselves to the priest while they were still lepers, and on the way they became well. So you see, there's a process, sometimes it takes some action on our part, but we also need to enter into the fight, and we need to feed ourselves with the Word of God. Isn't that beautiful? Go to Isaiah chapter 19. Isaiah 19, beginning in verse 19. In that day there will be an altar to the Lord in the midst of the land of Egypt. This is a very interesting prophecy that Isaiah is speaking here. And a pillar to the Lord near its border. And it will be a sign and a witness to the Lord of hosts in the land of Egypt. And they will cry to the Lord because of oppressors, and he will send them a Savior and a champion, and he'll deliver them. Thus the Lord will make himself known to Egypt, and the Egyptians will know the Lord in that day. And they'll even worship with sacrifice and offerings, and will make a vow to the Lord and perform it. And the Lord will strike Egypt, striking but healing. Verse 22. So they'll return to the Lord, and he will respond to them and will heal them. Yes, ma'am.
Has there been anything in history, in the past history, that would indicate that that happened once?
Not that I'm aware of. But I have not tried to do a lot of research about it. Not that I'm aware of. So that's a wonderful promise. Wouldn't that be something that happened in our day? But now we also can remember, Egypt is a picture of the world. Okay? And you know that God's children, we have to come out of Egypt, out of the world. We go through the desert, and we're headed to the promised land, the land flowing with milk and honey. Now, while that's a picture of the world, do you know that there's another level to the spiritual aspect of this in the Scripture? You see, this happened physically to Israel, but Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 10, everything that happened to them was written for our instruction upon whom the end of the ages have come. Therefore, let him who thinks he stands, a lot of people who think they do, take heed lest he fall. So while we say, yep, I came out of the world, I turned to Jesus, and I started going to church, and now I speak Christianese, and I go to ceremonies and all this, so I went to the promised land. Not necessarily. Because John comes along in Revelation and tells us, oh, by the way, Jerusalem, which is a picture of the church, the dwelling place of the people of God, is picturing the same thing that Egypt is. Say, what? So what we've discovered is, yes, it was a picture of us coming out of the world and coming to Jesus. And then the next thing you know, we get full of ourselves and our religion and our self-righteousness, and we think that we're better than other people, and you know, well, I really deserve, you know, for God to make himself known to me like other people. And guess what? We find ourselves back in Egypt. But we're at a different level, a little deeper level, or if you want to go the other way, a little higher level. Because Egypt is also a picture of the church, of religion. So we came out of the world. We think we're in the promised land, and we blink and we go, how do we get back here? Then we understand, here we are in bondage to religion. We're still back in Egypt. Now we got to come out again and go through the desert and head to the promised land. That's part of the mysteries of God that are recorded for us in the Scripture. So when you think of it in that vein, even while we're in religion, God will strike us to get our attention. But he will heal us. Do you see that that's really what he's saying right there? If you only think of it as physically Egypt, too, that's okay. Remember, if you're not too sure about it, we've got the... Now, I just used it for a barf bucket, but it doesn't have to be a barf bucket. I remind you, you hear something you're not sure about, you think it's a little bizarre, then just lob it over here. Throw in the bucket, and we'll just let it simmer back there. And I don't expect you to believe anything just because I say it. Because I don't want to be your teacher. I don't want to be your Lord. I want to see you walking with Jesus and Jesus being your Lord. Which means that he will probably lead you to do some things that I don't agree with. Or you might have some views that I don't see. That's okay. But don't just reject it offhand. Let it sit back there and simmer and ask God, is there any validity to this thing about Egypt being the church? By the way, there's one verse in Revelation that just unlocks it all. Babylon, Egypt, Jerusalem are all pictures of exactly the same thing according to John in Revelation. And no, I'm not going to give you the verse because you'll go read it. Go find it later. I want you to stay with me here. Do you see what this says? Meanwhile, back in Egypt, along the Nile, Moses in the bulrushes. Okay. Pharaoh's daughter. Okay. Listen to verse 22. The Lord will strike Egypt. Striking, but healing, so they'll return to the Lord, and he'll respond to them. See, that's when they cry. He's responding to them, and he'll heal them. Do you see that? Does God himself strike us? Well, He takes the credit for it. But many times it's actually loosing Satan. It's really the way it happens is the Lord withdraws his hedge of protection, which is precisely what happened with Job. You remember with Job? God said to Satan, listen to what he says. He remains faithful to me, even though, listen to what God says to him, and this is in Job chapter 2 after he's taken all of his property and his family and everything. And God says to Satan, although you incited me to ruin him without cause. You see, even though Satan did all of those things, the lightning strike, the windstorm, or meteorite, or whatever happened to kill all of his animals and his livestock, and all of these things that occurred, and it was the fire of God, it was the wind, all of this was done. We know that Satan did it, but God considered himself to have done it because he said, you incited me to ruin him without cause. So, basically, yes, God, how does he do it? He simply withdraws that hedge of protection around us that allows sickness and disease and tragedies and accidents and things to happen. Sometimes it's because of someone else exercising their free will. I know when my brother was shot in Lubbock, Texas, through the heart, God could have made the gun malfunction. But it didn't. Was it God's will for that to happen? Nope, it was not. It was not God's will. It's God's will for us to live a long life and to honor him. But, God gave the man freedom of choice, the one that killed my brother, just as much as he gave my brother freedom of choice. Yes, sir, brother.
I remember someplace, and you'll probably know where it is, and we don't want to know where it is, so we go look at it, but someplace, God said, refers to Satan as my servant.
Yes. He does.
Which kind of messes some people up when they
think that really does cause
the world is out of hand here. You know, things are out of God's hand, and he's trying his best to get them back in.
Exactly. And boy, that is one of the biggest deceptions. That's one of the biggest falsehoods perpetrated. This idea that some churches give, that God is in a battle with the devil and he needs to have us go rebuke the devil and bind him out of the city and cast him out of our county and get him out of our state. Folks, I got news for you. We don't have authority to do that. If we did, why don't we just send him to the moon and leave all of us alone? He's here because God sent him here. Now the question is, what are we going to do with him, and how is he going to influence our relationship with God? But he really is. He really is. In fact, I had a friend who used to teach a message called Satan, the Faithful Servant of God. But I'm telling you, that actually is true.
He's consistent.
Yes, he is. And by the way, We haven't looked at this in a while. Okay, I'm going to deviate. I've got two. It's your fault. It's your fault.
Sorry.
Okay, we are going to go. I want you to see this because I can hear. Okay. And by the way, good. Okay, again, I don't expect you to believe it just because I say it or because Mark says it. I want you to see what the Lord has to say here. We're going to have to go look at two passages at the same time. And it's in 1 Chronicles 21 for this episode. Okay? So you need to be in 1 Chronicles 21. And then if you'll back up to 2 Samuel 24. Okay, you need to have both at the same time. You've got to lay a piece of paper in there or something. Okay, so we have 2 Samuel 24. Okay, save your place there. 1 Chronicles 21. Now, as you're aware, in your studies through Chronicles and Kings and Samuel, there are some parallel accounts where Samuel records an account and then it's recorded over in Chronicles. And I used to, when I would see these things, I said, oh, I already read that over in Samuel, or I read Matthew, so why read it in Mark, And I'll tell you why. Because everything that's here is here because the Holy Spirit saw fit to record it. And for those who are diligent to study this word and to compare one place to another, the Lord drops nuggets. And this is a biggie. 2 Samuel 24, okay? And 1 Chronicles 21. Okay, sorry I don't have it on the board for you, so you're having to follow it out here. Okay, it's 2 Samuel 24, 1 Chronicles 21. And we'll start, since Samuel is a little closer to the front, we'll go 2 Samuel 24, we'll look at that verse first, and then we'll go over to 1 Chronicles. Okay, I hear pages rustling, but it's slowing down. Now, I do want you to have time. You need to. This is one you need to see in Mark, and then you'll be able to pull that line back out of the top back here. Or maybe move it from the back of the stove to the front of the stove. Okay, 2 Samuel 24. You ready? Now the anger of the Lord burned against Israel, and it incited David against them to say, go number Israel and Judah. Now, we can't pursue what this is all about. 70,000 men wind up dying because of the king's sin. But that's beside the nugget that he's given us here. So, the anger of the Lord burned against Israel, and God's anger incited David to say, I'm going to take this census so I can brag about how many soldiers and people I have. Samuel tells us, 24:1, the anger of the Lord burned against Israel, and it incited David to go number Israel. Now, save your place there. 1 Chronicles 21, verse 1 also.
Is that 1 Chronicles?
1 Chronicles 21, verse 1 is the second verse we need to look at. Here it is. Are you ready? Hold on to your hat. Then Satan stood up against Israel and moved David to number Israel. This is describing the exact same event. So who is correct? Is Samuel correct that it was the anger of the Lord? Or is the chronicler correct that it was Satan? We found, the Mormons told us the Bible had contradictions. We found one of those contradictions. No. This is one of the ways the Holy Spirit gives us nuggets of truth in God's Word. So was it the anger of the Lord? Or was it Satan? The answer was yes. So what is the anger of the Lord? The anger of the Lord is, he withdraws those angels, which 2 weeks from tonight we'll begin our study about the order of God and angels. It might behoove you to learn about the conditions for the angels of God to perform that hedge for you and your family. We're gonna see it in the scripture. And America doesn't like what it says. American society hates this, but we're going to look at it anyway, because let God be true, even if every man's a liar. And I know it's going to be risky to put it out on the internet, because, you know, I could wind up on the other side of Highway 79 here. But I want you to see. I want you to see. This is the truth. The truth is, God withdraws his head of protection. And Satan hates us because we have the favor of God, and the affection of God is set on us, and we are his inheritance out of all the magnificent things God's created in this world. We are his inheritance. This is what he wants. This is what he's looking for. It's not the gold in the mines. It's not the copper over at Superior. It's not the copper across the Gila River here. It's not church buildings. It's not the sequoia trees. It's not the whales. It's you and me. And because God set his affection on us, Satan detests and hates us. And every one of us would be dead for our desire to know God. Except he can't kill us, because God puts his protection around us. Okay? So in order for Satan to wreak havoc in our bodies and on our life, what does God have to do? He simply withdraws the hedge of protection. That is the anger of the Lord. So God and the devil fighting each other? God is absolutely God Almighty. Now, don't confuse that with the reality that you and I are in a battle with Satan. And I guarantee you, he's thrown some things in your pathway today, and he's done some things to you today. He is working for your demise and your destruction, and he doesn't like you finding out that Jesus has given you authority over him and all of his powers.
Praise God.
Isn't that awesome?
Yes.
It's awesome for us to know that. And he is afraid for us to know that. And so what has he been doing our whole lives? He's been throwing things at us to make us fearful of him, like movies like The Exorcist. Which, by the way, I've never seen, nor will I ever see it, because I know who wrote it. Okay? Because Satan inspired that to try to stir up fear in people to make us afraid of Satan. And he doesn't want you to know that we have authority to crush him under our foot. Jesus said, I've given you authority to trample serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall injure you. But don't rejoice in that. The 70 came back going, Jesus, this is awesome. The demons are subject to us in your name. We're casting out sicknesses. We're rebuking fevers. And we're rebuking the devil, and injuries get healed, apparently. That's some of what was going on. And Jesus goes, that's cool, I'm glad you learned that, but keep the focus where it needs to be. Don't rejoice in these things. The really good news is, rejoice, your names are recorded in the book of life. Because I'm going to shed my blood so that you can have your name written in that book. Thank you, Jesus. I mentioned again, in case some of you haven't heard this, but there was a company that was commissioned to do a worldwide study of the internet and see what are the most commonly searched questions that are put out there. And I was surprised to learn, as you may be surprised to learn, it was not pornography. The most searched things worldwide are, is there a God? God, are you out there? God, can I know you?
Wow.
Isn't that amazing to discover that? People want to really know if there really is a God. Now, I didn't ever see the demographics broken down. I'm not sure that would be the number one thing searched in the USA, because there's not as much appreciation and not as much hunger for the things of God in the US as there are in third world countries. And as I reiterate a couple of times, they are estimating 85,000 people a day are giving their life to Jesus Christ, the majority of whom are in third world countries. And I think they said around 75% of those were converted to Christianity and believing in Jesus because someone in their village or in their family was miraculously healed. Isn't that awesome? Praise the Lord.
What percent did you say? 75?
About 75% of those are converted because of miraculous things the Lord's doing. Yeah, Dave?
About 10 years ago, I talked to a Lutheran pastor from Africa, because he was here at our synod for a conference. And he told us, he said, during the 19th, early 20th century, you sent missionaries to us. He said, in the late 20th century and 21st century, we're going to send missionaries to you.
Right. Yes, yeah. Exactly. Yeah,
that's what they're saying in Africa. We're going to start sending missionaries to the United States. Yes. Yes, ma'am.
Well, during the inauguration, I saw on Facebook where they did a split screen. On the right side, it showed all of the crowd from the White House all the way back came through the memorial, the crowd. And they said there was over 1 million people there. And on the left screen, it was over 1 million people in the Philippines that were marching for God.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Split screen. That's quite a split screen.
Yeah, it was.
Yeah. Yes, Olrika.
I just saw on Facebook today where a suitcase of Bible made it to China. And they were literally in tears, kissing the Bible. And so grateful.
If you didn't hear, a suitcase of Bibles made it to China, and the people were kissing the Bibles. They were so treasured and so grateful to get it. I heard about somewhere in East Asia that someone at a river saw a piece of paper floating in the river, and it was a page out of the Bible. And they took it into their village, and their whole village was converted to Christianity. Cause of their hunger to know the truth. So, folks, we're living in an amazing time, and you have a vested interest in that, and you know, and helping with what we're doing. Again, if you would click on the left side, the red button says subscribe. That will help us get viewed. And if you have a Facebook, you can click on that and say like, and then you'll get those updates. And it's just another hand through which the Lord can get a hold of someone's heart. And and by the way, the cost is just what we're doing here in Michael and Heather's time, and it's wonderful that we have that opportunity. Something that 50 years ago would only have been dreamed of. So praise the Lord. Yes, Larry?
On the contrary, Reedy just said they were kissing the Bible. Sunday after the Super Bowl, did you see the audacity of these men kissing the Lombardi Trophy? Oh. That goes to show you what America's tuned into.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, and you know, it symbolizes a lot of lifetime ambition for people and all that. Yeah, it's interesting. For the things that fade away. Yes, sir, Rob.
You were talking about people coming to the Lord in other countries. I was on a bus in Latin America going from Limon, Costa Rica to San Jose, and it was at night. And in the very back of the bus, I hear somebody crying. A little bit later, there's somebody up closer crying. A little bit later, somebody else is crying. This crying just keeps moving up. And pretty soon, it's like three seats behind me, and I hear this guy says, "Does anyone have a Bible on the bus?" And so I pulled one out of my backpack and passed it back to him. After a while, this guy has moved his way up on the bus as he sat by me. And I started asking what was going on. He was a doctor out of San Jose that once a week had to go down to Limon to teach lessons at the college. And 1 week his car broke down. Instead of driving, he took the bus. And seven people got saved. So he just quit taking his car.
And just started
he says, every week, four or five people on Wednesday get saved on the bus. You know, and maybe we ought to quit driving a car sometimes. Get with the public. You know? I mean, we tend to just put two people in the car rather than the city park or whatever. It was interesting that, you know, people are just crying and giving their life to the Lord on the way home.
People are hurting the world over. And they want to see the real Jesus. They don't want religion. They don't want traditions. They don't want ceremonies. They want Jesus. And that's awesome. Jesse, if you don't mind, I'd like you to come up and tell us a little bit about your report Everybody that's known a little bit about Jesse over the last couple of years is always asking me, what's the latest word on Jesse? And I'm telling you, tonight, I've known Jesse for a little less than, a little over 2.5 years. And tonight, you look the best that you've looked in the 2.5 years I've known you.
I tell you guys, thank you very much. The Lord has blessed me to have each and every one of you in my life. I consider each and every one of you my family. You know, I've been fighting leukemia, then I fought Hodgkin's lymphoma, and then the uranium that they found in my organs that was killing me. And I was believing in that, and I was falling in these ropes. I tell you tonight that when I went to go, come the 21st of January, I mean, I had a lot of sweet things going on in my life these last 2.5 years. When I tried to, 3 years, I've been falling, trying to get into falling in the Lord. And it seems like whenever I took one step forward, 5 steps would knock me back. And I'd get that, the devil, I'd let the saint put the doubt in me, and I was letting that happen. And I'm not a quitter, by all means. All my time when I was in the service, in the special forces, I didn't appreciate life. I didn't. I was a very highly decorated soldier. I didn't appreciate the blessings I had then. I got out and I had a lot of doubt. I thought I had to do good to fill in for the gap that I, of the bad that I thought I did. I thought I was doing it for God and country, which then I found out it was for dirty politicians. Nor here or there. The 21st, I received a phone call from VA. It was at nighttime. And I had already been lost. And I was getting the tailspin because they told me I had 11 weeks, not too long from before that. And I said, How is this? I don't cheat, lie, do drugs, I don't steal from people. Why is it that I'm getting beat down like this? I lost my family. I lost my immediate family. They broke me off. Just acquaintances. Everybody but you folks, my family here. And the 21st thing was they called and they said, hey, Mr. Gim, you know, they had to go through the process to make sure it was you. I said, yeah. And it's at night. I said, what's going on? He said, well, the results came in. I'm like, well, you call me this late, it's got to be good. And they said, no, sir, tomorrow you're going to start feeling septic. You got septic, and you're going to also have a season to be hitting you soon. We got to get you in and get you treated. And I said, I don't believe this. I said, I don't know my body. I don't believe this. I believe in the Lord. But then I started to think, after I hung up and talked to them, I let it sink in. I let the devil get in and put those thoughts in. And boy, did I tell you what, everything they said I was going to start happening, it was happening. Not to speak grossly here, but you know, I was bleeding from every orifice. I lost my vision, lost my hearing. I got very bitter and full of hate. And I said, you know what, maybe that was my calling, is doing all that hate stuff. Maybe that was my calling. That's the devil convinced me there again. I yelled at the Lord. I told him, see, I knew you weren't real. Even after all the blessings that I've been receiving, kept my house, my daughter in my life, you folks in my life. And still I had that doubt. Well, the hardest thing was, a week after that, I had to check in the hospice. It took me 6 days to go check in for the end of life care. I thought I was a strong man. I thought I was a decisive man, almost. Good, bad, or different. It wasn't me. It was the good Lord. I know that now. I didn't know that then. Anyways, I checked in that day. I said, I can't believe my life is here. I'm going to check into hospice. Is this the big plan you said that you got for me? Is I'm going to die here? I'm going to die of an organ at a time? Great plan, Lord. And that's what I was telling. I was telling the truth with you. But that was the devil letting me convince myself to let get into me and thinking that. I remember that day, it took me 6 days to get to that office and make that phone call and check in. The lady at the counter was no help at all. So I remember she said, well, let me look you up in the system. Yeah, you're supposed to be here a week ago. I said, well, ma'am, it took me all the gold to get here. And she said, I see you're a veteran. And I said, yes, ma'am, I am. I just told you the VA sent me down here. I said, I got to check in. This is easy for me. She says, well, you have arsenal in your house. Well, of course I got arsenal, ma'am. I said, I was a special forces, and that's what I love to do. And I go, what's that got to do with checking in here? I said, you know, I'll tell you how hard it was to get here. You know, and make this call and to check in this place. My life is ended. And she goes, well, I don't know why we care, you veterans. And I said, well, excuse me? She goes, yeah, I don't even believe in the U.S. flag. That just fired me up right there. I gave a lot of it. I said, well, I went off on it. It was wrong of me. I'm not no bigger or better than anybody else. I shouldn't have treated that way like I did. But a lot of men and women fought for that, you know, for our flag. Laid their lives down for the freedom we have today, and that really hurt me. So the devil got back into me, and if I was within reach, I probably would have ended her life. I guarantee I would have. It would have been bad. I'm glad I wasn't there. I had the Lord in my hands. hung up, and I had to fence, so I called Mr. Straits. Called Mr. Straits and calmed me down. And then I cried.
Thank you, Lord. Bless you, Jesus.
Then I got a phone call on Saturday, the following Saturday after that. No, I believe it was Friday or Saturday, 27th. It said, Mr. Ganfie again. I said, here we go. Now what? I went and grabbed my Bible. I said, here we go again. I'm not going to let you get into me. You know, I'm always starting myself, and I'm always yelling at the devil to rebuke him, and I'm on the side of Jesus. Get that phone call. They say, you got to check in by the first. You know, you got your results again. I said, man, no. Results? Where do you guys get these results from? Because you guys have just been toying with my emotions for 3 years. And I said, well, why do I got to go there? If I'm a dying man, there's no cure for what I got. It wasn't the cancer. I beat the cancers already. But I had uranium in me from when I was in the Middle East. And in the waters, I got uranium in me. And then the soldiers that were involved in that area at that time, there's no cure. And they're dying. And it's really hard death. And I don't like medicine. I don't like taking medication. I don't take it because I just believe in, you know, natural stuff. And everybody knows about it. Well, I was really confused. Now I was like, well, here we go. And they said, well, you're down to the very end. And I was like, well, I already did my will, my videos to my daughter. You know, a lot of things. I already gave my rental houses up to my renters. You know, I gave up. I gave up so much that I was having suicidal thoughts. But then I thought of you. The devil left. The Lord got everything. He says, you got family we're talking about. You got people prepared to live. Amen. He goes, get back to the farm and pray. That's what I'm doing all other week. I said, all right. I want to get my mind right. I want to check in on the first. Got there. I said, dude, what's this about? I got more blood work. What does he guys want? No, I ended up going to a conference room. I said, here we go again. Because I was in the Hesco Skeleton program not too long ago, which I was glad able to get out of that. But they really hooked me there. Anyhow. Not to veer off any more time, we're studying. Walking ahead and had to meet with the department head of oncology, department head of pharmacy, department head of neurology, the University of Arizona department head for there, and then there was one more, I can't remember who that was. I'm sitting there with all these big wigs, I'm like, what's going on? You know, I said, and every time I had these meetings, they'd push that exoskeleton program out. You know, let's get you back in here. We have cures for you. I see people in the exoskeleton program where they can regrow limbs in 6 days. I was in a base that was 6 tiers below grade, which is about 60, 70 feet, whole another base. Things that I could, that you can see in movies were actually happening. I had gear, and I could show you photos. I still got some out here. I could see through mouth. I had gamma guns, gamma rays. So I was like, I'm not going back to that. That's Satan. That's Satan stuff. I don't know. I'm demonic. I don't want that. That's not the way Jesus wanted things. And I was able to get out of the grace of God. So, anyhow, I said, what is it now? And they said, well, for the better of mankind, can you please tell us how you did it? And I said, I'm tired of mankind. I said, excuse my friends. I went off in every church word you could think. I said, that's what I think about mankind. I said, no, the better mankind, you guys want me to be a lab rat? You guys want me to jump in this? You want to control my mind? You want to wipe my memory? Because we, you know, us that were in the special portion, well, you still use this. And us that were in that group, you know, we're all for the same criteria. We all have resentment. You know, this, this, and that, and the other. Why to get back into our lives when we call it normal, which was not normal. And I said, no. You know, I got Jesus with me. I said, no, I'm not going to do it for mankind. They said, well, please help us. I said, you want to call my attorney? I'm calling my attorney. Because I got issues that I had, you know, from surgeries and stuff that I was fighting with the VA. He was right there in Tucson. 20 minutes he came. He came up and he gave me a hug and looked at that report because they gave me reports to read, but I had no clue how to read these medical reports. And I was full of anger, full of hate. I mean, I was full, so much full of hate. I wanted to go to my truck, grab my weapons. Lucky I didn't bring them that day. I just bring my Bible right away. So all of a sudden, Mr. Rodriguez, he just gets up, gives me a big hug, and starts crying. And I was like, whoa, Mr. Rodriguez, what's wrong? Did you get a phone call from your family? Yeah, because, you know, what's going on? Are you all right? I said, we're here for me. I don't know, but I'm here for you. You know, what's wrong? Let's go. You got something to explain? I know your business. I'll go with you. You need my support. And he goes, you don't know? I said, don't know what? And I said, what are you talking about? And he grabs that paper and goes, you really truly did? They didn't explain that to you? I said, no, sir, I'm not here for them. I don't believe they're practicing this. You know, I said, I want you to break it down. The layman terms for me. He says, it's all gone. He said, what's all gone? That's what's going to the program, or what's gone? My mind, what? He says, oh, let me back up a little bit. I had already began to get rashes. I had welts. I was seeping blood out of my skin. I lost my vision, my hearing. I was losing my bones were because the calcium, lack of calcium, they were just breaking. I touched something, and my bones were just breaking. So he says, yeah, all you had was a blood infection. He goes, everything else that you had, and the septic, and the ringing. I mean, I've seen it. I even paid for two other facilities to test me and make sure I got it. You know, believe me. It was gone. And I was like, wow. I said, well, I still don't believe it. I'm going to go pay some more to somebody and go get tested again. And then they said, so tell us, please, how did you do this? And I said, I'll tell you what I've got. My Lord, my attorney goes, no, don't do this. He thought I was going to get my weapons. That's what I used to run to. And I said, I ran back to my, I have my daughter's car. Because the grace of God gave me back to me, brought my daughter back to my life. And I had her car, she had her car broke down, and I had to bring home fix it. She was in the car, she had my truck. I went back to her car, and I grabbed my Bible, and I ran back up there. I'm in no shape anymore, so I'm up there huffing and puffing. I said, give me a minute, and I laid down this, and I grabbed my Bible. As hard as I could slam it on that table, I came to slam it, and then I eased it on down. And I said, here we go. That's what I was doing right here. Put my faith in. They couldn't believe it. They didn't believe it. I said, you know what? I said, that's what you guys need to do. I said, you don't have to be in any religion, whatever. You have to be in a certain religion. I said, but get into the Word. I said, listen, I'm going to tell you, I did not believe. I remember being at that church right over here with Pastor Don. People laying their hands on me. I don't like them to touch me. And now you can hug me all you want. I'll hug you back. I went there and they laid my hands in and they said, how you feeling? Are you feeling okay? And I was like, because I lost my sight. And I said, yeah, sure. Yeah, I didn't believe it. The next morning, I woke up and I could see. I was like, whoa. That was kind of freaking me out. And I thought, well, that's just coincidence. And from there, I just kept getting blessings and blessings. And I still didn't believe it. I was like, not a coincidence. No, it can't be. And I was looking for, you know, some other type of answer besides believing. And I'm here to tell you that God is real.
Yes,
and nothing can ever do. I feel great. I can sit there and just jump rope all day. I get back and lifting weights and running and swimming and jumping and plant the seed of Jesus in people. I'm here to say, I got a whole question. I'm going to say, this is different one. Thank you for the faith and the love. Thank you.
Lord Jesus, we're just in awe of you. We're amazed at this young man right here. He's just like a young man. He looked like an old man there for a few months, Lord. It's like he's got a new body. We thank you for your wonderful healing touch. Thank you for the heart of a warrior that you put in him. And maybe some of the things he was sent to do were not the right things, but God, he did it as faithfully as those who served King David and those who served King Saul and Solomon. And God, we know that you honor those who risk their lives. You told us the greater love is no man than this, that he lay down his life for his friends. And risking lives for people that we don't even know, and many times we're ungrateful. That's what our military has done over and over and over again. And thank you, Lord. We just rejoice in good report. We rejoice and we're in awe tonight, Lord, of all that you've done in Jesse's body and with his mind and with his vision. And God, we just ask you to reach out and touch him tonight and continue to restore every challenge and every problem in his body, God. We gave up a long time ago trying to figure it out, Lord. We don't understand it, but we know it's you. And you're for real.
Yes.
And this calling on you is not playing games. It's body changing, life transforming, and heart renewing. And we thank you, Lord. You do that for us because you love us.
Yes, Jesus. Lord. Jesus.
Amen.
Yes, we have.
And brother, that's what you need to understand is that when there's a need,
Don't keep it to yourself. It's not a burden. It's not a nuisance. This is what we live for, is the joy of sharing the goodness of God and the mercy and the healing of Jesus and His forgiveness with everyone who's willing. What's that?
And we're His family.
And we are your family, brother. That's right. You remember that when Jesus was first starting to preach, His family had thought that He had lost His mind, particularly because He was annoying the religious leaders, and they just couldn't conceive of it could possibly be of God that Jesus is out there saying things that is enraging the religious leaders. It certainly couldn't have been of God. And somebody cried one day out, they shouted out, said, "Jesus, your mother and your sisters and brothers are here." And the scripture says they had come to take custody of Him. And Jesus said, "Who is my mother? Who are my brothers and sisters? But these who hear the word of God and do it." That's where family is. And brother, we want to be your family. Just a couple of the others. The verse from Micah, it's the last one on my page that's up on the screen for you. But it says that many nations will come and say, "Come and let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, that He may teach us His ways, and that we may walk in His paths. Even from Zion will go forth the law and the word of God, and He will judge between many peoples." And that desire and that hunger to go up to the house of the Lord. God's stirring that up in us. One more last one I want to read to you is 3 John 1. If you want to look at it, the little book of 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John that's right before the Revelation, the last book in the Bible there. 3rd John, there's really even only one chapter, so. But it's something really powerful that he says there. As John is writing this, he says, "Beloved, I pray that in all respects you may prosper and be in good health, just as your soul prospers." When your heart and your walk with God is prospering, he said, everything else is going to prosper too, and you're going to be in good health. Thank you, Lord Jesus. All of these other verses, great and powerful verses. The last one that I have listed on the page for you, we're not going to read it, but I just want to tell you. Jesus went out, and it says, as he was in the face of the religious leaders, many unbelievers, hard-hearted people, people that wanted to kill him. And that Luke passage says, the last one on your list says, "And the power of the Lord was present for him to perform healing." And Jesus healed people in the face of adversity and unbelief and so forth. So folks, that's what we need to be looking for. We're going to get help for our own health and help for those that are in need. We need the power of the Lord to be present for healing. And many times we experience that power in a special measure after we had our minds on the Word of God or we're singing praises and worshiping, and the Lord shows up in power. And that's the time that we want to tap into those resources of God for healing.